Greetings, people. Paul Muckle here again. Today is October 26, 2012, around 7:10 p.m. Eastern Time. Here comes the moon, the October moon. It's gonna be a full moon in a couple of days for Halloween. It's also gonna help that super weather bomb that's coming to America, the eastern coast of America. Hey people, in September, what it was, September 7th, I think, didn't I release a video telling you all that Paul Muckle threatened to weather bomb election 2012? I said it right, then I'll be releasing a few videos, you know, showing you all what's gonna come, the weather bomb that's gonna come. Well, was I right or was I right? Huh? You know where the bomb coming, people, 1 week before the election? Well, all I can say to you people, I hope you all be safe, you know? Take safety precautions. These things have to happen, you know what I'm saying? Because people laugh at me, you know, they make fun of me and say, oh, you don't know what you're talking about. And I don't know, I have a sense about this thing, I'm not trying to brag, but nothing that I truly desire shall be withheld from me. And one day you are going to wake up and realize that Paul Muckle, what I say happened. I mean, when I was locked up in May and July 2012, then some serious town week, half of y'all had eclipse, y'all had weather bombs, y'all had the sun spewing out this huge plasma energy. I mean, wow, I went through some terrible punishment when I was locked up in May, from May 1st till July 3rd. So, you know, my rabbi will never forsake me. So anyway, this is not a war against the people, this is a war on Babylon, this is a war on capitalism, because the economy is what's gonna suffer. Okay, Wall Street's gonna suffer. And until you all stop taking people's house away from them, until you all stop playing games and giving people jobs, and stop taking people's houses away, we're gonna wreck your economy. So people, take precaution, okay? And sorry for the victims now, but what is to be must be. I warned you all, it's gonna come. And some people didn't take me seriously. So here we go.
The war is actually begun. The next gale that sweeps from the north will bring to our ears the clash of resounding arms. Our brethren are already in the field. Why stand we here idle?
The cops grabbed me and dragged me off of the garage, head down, you know, bang up my head against a piece of metal. People, they brutalized me on that day, okay? Took my clothes on, taking pictures of me and laughing at me, and take my money, steal my money from me, people. And they get caught on camera by their own cops. And stole my money from me, took my clothes, forced me to the hospital, and gave me 4 injections, put a robe on me, and laugh at me, and ridicule me, and say, prophesy, what's going to be the lucky number tonight? What's going to happen tomorrow? This is what the cops did to me, okay? This is what the cops did to me, so.
A superstorm headed for the northeast. Hurricane Sandy has lost some strength, but forecasters warn the storm is extremely powerful. It's already left more than 20 dead across the Caribbean. Now states from Florida to Massachusetts are bracing for pounding wind, rain, widespread power outages. There could be snow, and it could last for days. CNN meteorologist Chad Myers is tracking Sandy. Chad, this weather system is, I mean, literally, it's massive. Tell us how big it is, how wide the impact will be.
It will be all the way from Maine to North Carolina. Every state in that area will get some type of damage. The storm now just leaving the Bahamas, and it will be making its way on up to the northeast. We don't know where it's going to go yet. The computer models are all the way from Rhode Island, all the way back to about Washington, D.C. But I will guarantee you this, Eric, that every place in this circle will have some type of damage, whether it's wind, whether it's trees knocked down, power lines knocked down, coastal erosion, or flooding. One of our companies that we buy things from, one of our vendors, WTT, said that this may be, in some spots, a 1,000-year flood. It's kind of like what we had in Vermont from Irene last year. We all know that.
Well, is there a danger the storm could gain strength? I mean, you're talking about a storm doing all the things you just said at a Category 1, possibly. Could it get even bigger?
It probably doesn't get bigger. It may get to be a 100 mile per hour storm. It could be a small Category 2. The issue is not so much that it's a Category 1, because it spins around here and stays for a long time. Another issue is that there's a big high-pressure ridge to the west of it. And so when you have high pressure on one side, and even a small low pressure on the other, you get a lot of wind. But we have a big low pressure and a big high pressure, so wind away from this storm, 200 miles away from the center of Sandy, could have winds of 80 to 90 miles per hour. That's tremendous. That's a widespread swath of damage.
And do you think it could affect early voting? I mean, from what you're describing, it would seem yes, right?
I don't see how it doesn't affect early voting. We are going to have hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people without power. We can't get all those power lines back up all at once. It may take till Wednesday or Thursday of next week to get that power back up. We're going to have coastal erosion. We're going to have a million trees down from all this wind. It's widespread. It's Maine, Vermont, New Hampshire, Massachusetts. Even if you don't get the center of the storm of the eye, you're still going to get damage.
Wow. Thank you very much, Chad Myers. Pretty frightening scenario you just laid out. And talking about the effect on early voting, the massive storm is also wreaking havoc on the campaign trail tonight. Governor Romney and Vice President Biden have canceled weekend events along the East Coast, where many states have already declared a state of emergency. In addition to disrupting travel, the storm is also threatening to derail early voters. But which candidate could be more effective? CNN contributors Ryan Slum and Roland Martin are up front. Good to see both of you. And Roland, we're going to be in a lot of these states making a big and intense push. Does it affect one of them more than the other?
No, it affects both of them and really game this thing out. Remember, early voting is one thing, but what do you do if you have significant damage, if you have Americans loss of life, and you still have commercials up on television, you're pounding away at each other? For the president, I think it actually helps him a little bit more, because remember, he's a sitting president.
Right.
He gets to be presidential. He might have to tour these areas, talk to residents, declare emergency areas as well. But it's going to be hard for each campaign to actually justify in North Carolina, in New Hampshire, in Wisconsin, let's say in Virginia, running ads attacking each other while Americans are suffering due to this storm. So they're going to have a tough call in it.
Ryan, let me ask you about that point. The president, he is a sitting president. He's going to have to tour if there are disaster areas and people who are dead. So not only does it give him that moment, maybe Romney can do that too, but it does give that moment to the president. What about all these nasty ads they're running about each other in all these states? Isn't that inappropriate too?
You know, I think that it's part of the spirit of the campaign. I think those ads are, designed to draw contrast, and I think that's fair enough. But I certainly think it's true that, as Roland had suggested, that it's all about the net effect. Because again, both campaigns are having to cancel events, right?
Yes.
So the thing is that it's really important to see and the key thing is Virginia. That's a swing state, right? But a lot of these other states, they're not swing states. New Hampshire is a swing state. It's not clear how it's going to impact New Hampshire. So in terms of
Virginia, you see John King lay out these maps, if Virginia were to, feel sympathetic to the president going through this and him touring and being their commander-in-chief, that could turn the whole thing.
Yeah, but I think that actually voters, their views about the candidates at this point are pretty baked in. I can see how you really want to be mindful of whether or not your voters are getting to polls, because it's true that, Democratic voters tend to be more likely to be early voters, but of course Republican voters tend to be more likely to be elderly, and so it's possible that they will be heavily impacted by a storm that actually limits their mobility and what have you. So I think that there's a lot to be concerned about on both sides.
I have one thing, Aaron. Here's the problem for the president. He has to figure out, when do I remain at the White House, monitoring this whole deal, being the president of the United States while also trying to campaign. Mitt Romney doesn't have to do that. He can actually still go to Ohio, go to Wisconsin, go out west, so they can say, sure, we'll take down ads in Virginia, but the campaign still continues. And so I think that's where it's going to be dicey for the president, justifying being president, but also being candidate Obama.
Right, and I guess for Romney, the flip of what you said, Roland, might be, you don't want to be out in Nevada saying vote for me while the East Coast is sucking. That's a bad image too, right?
That's what it's all about, the optics. And you don't want people saying how callous of you. Americans are suffering. Here they are, they have damaged homes, and they're having to rebuild their lives, and you're running around spending millions of dollars on campaign ads. It's not a good look for the candidate.
That's right. So let's talk about early voting. Ronnie, you made the case that this is going to affect both of them. But the people that don't vote in the 3 or 4 days that this affects their state, 2 days, whatever it is, some of them might not vote at all, right? I mean, are you thinking votes are still going to come out later, or...
That's a really thorny question. My guess is that those voters aren't going to turn out if they are intensely committed to either candidate. If they're not intensely committed, that's a concern for both campaigns. They need to actually motivate those guys, and that would be true whether or not we had an enormous storm. So I think that the question is, who is at the margin? And I think that if they were really that marginal that they wouldn't show up later on, then it's possible there are all kinds of other things that could have deterred them from turning out to vote.
But we're all
the problem is damage, Aaron.
Yeah.
The problem is damage. I mean,
yes.
Again, forget just power lines being down. If you have homes destroyed, having to be rebuilt, if you have folks' cars damaged or whatever, trust me, from a priority standpoint, you're sitting here trying to deal with your life, your children, your family, the elderly, and so that's the real issue. I wouldn't be surprised in those states right now where you have early voting, you're going to see massive turnout tomorrow trying to get ahead of this storm. In North Carolina, in Ohio, even in Illinois, they said lines have been long, they've been running out of paper, and so I probably would say the places where they're voting early right now, they're going to be crashing and burning Saturday and Sunday in advance of the storm.
All right, show us that they're fascists. Here for them. Thanks to both. Great to see you. A good weekend. Still to come, a very big development in the deathly meningitis outbreak.